Thank you to Trade Coffee for supporting this episode of SciShow. You can go to drinktrade.com/scishowoffer to get a free bag of coffee with any subscription purchase. This video is not about the climate crisis. Yes, the climate crisis does mean coastal cities will experience rising sea levels and more frequent, potentially devastating flooding. But here's what they're not telling you. In many coastal cities, the land is sinking much faster than the sea is rising, making all that flooding that much more of a problem. The issue? It's our extremely unavoidable need for water in the first place. But if we can put some of that water back where it came from, we might just be able to stop these cities from drowning. The technical term for when the ground sinks is subsidence, and it can cause more than just floods. Shifting ground can damage the foundations of buildings and other infrastructure like roads and sewer systems. It used to be the sort of thing people would only notice when that kind of damage happened and something cracked. Or in really extreme cases, like where massive amounts of groundwater are used for irrigating farms, like in the San Joaquin Valley in California, where the ground has sunk as much as 9 meters since the 1920s. But today, we have satellites that can constantly monitor tiny and gradual changes in ground movement. Interferometric Synthetic Aperture Radar, or INSAR for short, begins with a satellite bouncing a pulse of radar off the Earth and recording the returning signal. This essentially measures the distance between the ground and the satellite. The satellite does this over and over again over a long period and then compares each image. This can measure very slight changes in ground movement, even as little as a few millimeters. A 2022 study looked at INSAR data from 99 coastal cities around the world. Subsidence doesn't only affect cities along the coast, but that's often where the flood risk is the greatest. They found that 33 of them have areas that are sinking over 10 millimeters a year. That's 5 times faster than sea level rise caused by the climate crisis. This means devastating floods will occur sooner and will be worse than expected, compared to predictions that only account for sea level rise. The fastest subsidence rates are in Asia. Rates as high as 28 centimeters per year have been seen in one area of Jakarta. Worldwide, 1.2 billion people live in an area that is prone to high subsidence. Building big, heavy buildings does contribute to this somewhat. A 2023 study calculated the weight of all buildings in New York at 764 billion kilograms. Because comparisons are fun, that's more than the total weight of all living humans. And New York City is sinking at 1 to 2 millimeters a year. But New York is on the heavier side of cities worldwide, and this isn't a huge amount of sinking compared to other places, which means something else has to be the main factor. Globally, the biggest factor contributing to cities sinking is pumping out groundwater from beneath them. After you build a city, the people that live there need to drink and take showers, wash dishes, and have water fights. So lots of people living in a place also tends to lead to more groundwater being extracted. When we say groundwater, we're not talking about some deep cave that fills up with water. It's the water that can fill up tiny gaps in porous rock or space between grains of sediment. If a layer of ground can hold water in it, that layer is called an aquifer. But the presence of water in those little gaps also helps hold the layer up. Some aquifer materials, like fine sediments, will collapse a bit after the water is taken away. Not only does this mean the ground above sinks, it also smushes the aquifer and causes it to lose some of its water capacity. So in the future, when natural sources of water refill it, it's not going to hold as much. Ultimately, the most important thing to stop this is to reduce how much groundwater we are extracting. Of course, that's easier said than done if a city doesn't have another viable source of fresh water. Globally, 30% of household water and 40% of farm water comes from the ground. Regulating groundwater has worked in many places. In 2010, Jakarta brought in stricter regulation and licensing of groundwater pumping. As of 2020, subsidence had slowed. Instead of rates as high as 280 millimeters per year, it was looking more like 20. Although, one suburb was sinking at more than twice that rate due to continued groundwater extraction. Those are still some of the fastest rates in the world. And unlicensed pumps are a big problem. So even stricter groundwater regulations were put in place in 2023. The issue is that as of 2020, 60% of the people in Jakarta still relied on groundwater. So the goal is to build water pipes to reach everyone by 2030. Then there's the Coachella Valley in California, which sank over half a meter between 1995 and 2010. So they switched to the Colorado River for some of their water and slowed subsidence by around 50 to 75%. Of course, that's not exactly a perfect fix, given the Colorado River is at its limits. As of 2023, states are being asked to cut back their use of it. Some places are going even further and trying to reverse some of the damage done by pumping water back into the ground. This is known as managed aquifer recharge. Essentially, you drill a well down to the aquifer, but instead of pumping water out, you pump water in. This can be tens of millions of liters a day, so it can even reverse some subsidence. In Perth, Australia, they were able to lift the ground by 20 millimeters over about 3.5 years. While water banking has a lot of potential, it also has big issues to overcome. It's expensive, and you still need to get that fresh water to pump back in from somewhere. In many places, there's not an easy way to stop the ground sinking and ensure plentiful fresh water for decades and centuries to come. But we are making progress. Thanks to modern satellites, we can see the effects of the ground beneath our feet much sooner, which makes it a lot easier to try and do something about it. This SciShow video is supported by Trade Coffee, a company that can ship over 450 different coffees directly to you. Trade connects you to over 55 roasters in the US. So whether you like dark roasts, espresso, blends, or rare roasts, you can find it at Trade Coffee. And if you like anything coffee, you can get them all. But they keep you from getting overwhelmed by guiding you through the process and matching you to coffees uniquely suited to your taste. Once you've picked the perfect coffee, they'll ship it within 48 hours of being roasted so you can enjoy the freshest cup of coffee in your home or office every time. This time of year, you can warm up with their sweet and smooth holiday blend coffee made in Oregon. It's a medium roast with notes of milk chocolate, ripe fruit, and citrus. To try it for yourself, you can go to drinktrade.com/scishowoffer to get a free bag of coffee with any subscription purchase. Thanks to Trade Coffee for supporting this video, and thank you for watching.